A very warm good afternoon to everyone present. I welcome you all to Gyandut program organized by Department of College Education, Rajasthan. I am Dr. Madhvika Mathur, Associate Professor, Department of English, and my topic is postcolonial writings. So I'll begin with what does the term postcolonial mean? So post means after. And colonialism, so it is post-colonialism, it is the study of a culture after the physical and political withdrawal of an oppressive power. So without colonialism, wouldn't be no colonialism. So colonialism is about the dominance of a strong nation, like any European nation, over a weaker one. Mostly the natives of Asia, Africa, Australia, and America. So post-colonial writing, it basically engages the history of oppression, how colonial past and even now when countries are free, but they are still under neo-colonial or neo-imperial influence. For example, America and Britain, we are still under their influence. They are still ruling us. But that is virtually. We follow their culture, we follow their language. So this is what is neo-colonialism is. Despite of being free, still we are under the influence of these colonies. We have a long history of oppression, injustice, and racism. So post-colonial writings, basically they focus on issues of race, on ethnicity, on ethnic minority. It also talks about Dalits and other indigenous community, indigenous, the natives of that particular place. Postcolonial writing, it also talks about diasporic literature. That is people who have settled far away from their homeland. So it is the literature of those people. It also talks about the migrants and the refugees. So post-colonial literature, it is also the literature of emancipation. How people, they have changed, how they have transformed over the period of time, and how now new realities have come into existence. So the countries like Asia, Africa, Australia, America, now we are free of that rule. We are not under European rule anymore. So the literature which has been written by the writers of these places, they are depicting their past, their experiences, and how they have transformed over the period of time. This is what will be discussed in postcolonial literature today. Focusing on the key concepts, the first term is hybridity, mimicry, then demonic others, decolonization. So hybridity, which is actually a metaphor taken from biology, and it is used to refer any kind of cultural mixing or mingling between East and West, any kind of mingling. So this term, it was discussed by Homi Bhabha, and he describes how the emergence of a new cultural form came into existence, which was a multicultural society, that is cultural, which had characteristics of both the colonizer and the colonized. So who's the colonizer? The Europeans colonized the countries that were under the dominion of the European Empire. So hybridity, that is having the characteristics of both the cultures. Then there is another term, which is mimicry. So like Bhabha's concept of hybridity, mimicry is a metonym of presence. Mimicry means to imitate. Okay, it appears when members of a colonized society take on the culture of the colonized. That is not only the language, we are adapting their culture as well. We are imitating them. So Bhabha, he even writes almost the same. What did he say about mimicry? That it is almost the same, but not quite, not exactly the same. It is just an imitation of them. Then demonic other. So these Europeans, they assume that those who are different from oneself are inferior. They considered them as savage, backward, and even evil. So people of Asia, Africa, the colonized nations, people living there, the residents, they were considered as inferior, even savage, and at times evil. Decolonization, it is the process of revealing and dismantling colonist power in all forms. Not only removal of the domination of non-indigenous forces, but it also refers to decolonization of minds. That is, their thoughts which are hovering still over our minds. It is referring to decolonization of minds as well. And this has been very well explained in the book by Friends Fenn, Black Skin, White Mask, and Bugiwa Tuango, Decolonizing the Mind, the Politics of Language in African Literature. Speaking about Gayatri Chakravarti Spivak, she has put this concept in her book, Can Subalterns Speak? One more thing about, one more term which is there is Commonwealth Literature. So this term, again, it is related to post-colonial literature. And Commonwealth, it is a term that came into use in 1960s. And it was first used by Oliver Cromwell. It covers the literary work from territories that were once part of the British Empire. It is a multidimensional study and records the process that changed the life and status of the natives. It brought slaves under centuries of dominion. So this term, it means common well-being. The word common, which was used in England to mean a political community founded for the common good, for the common well-being of the community. Although it is a vague term which defines English language works written in the former British colonies, also known as New English Literature. And we'll see there are very diverse writers who wrote variety of literature, which came under the umbrella term of Commonwealth Literature. So some of the very prominent writers were Salman Rushdie, who is an Indian-born British-American novelist and essayist, R.K. Narayan, who is an Indo-English writer, Ruth Pravar Jabberwal, and Sir Kazuo Ishiguro, who was born in Nagasaki and is a British novelist. Now coming to the post-colonial writings. Although I have defined what post-colonialism is, I'm so sorry. Coming to the writings of different prominent writers, through post-colonial literature, writers, they have tried to reclaim their own past. So this literature, it is about a lot of changes that have happened down the history. So when we read post-colonial literature, we find it is a literature of diversity. We talk about different communities, different cultures. This literature, it is not a homogeneous one, but arbitrary and highly ambivalent. To begin with, I'll start with Indian literature in English. So from 1947 to 1980s, India was a post-colonial country. But in contemporary world, today's world, it is the post-colonial India with vibrant, diverse output of writing. The new generation of writers have focused on themes of new urban realization, globalization, modernity, postmodernity, and on the regional and cultural aspects of India. Some of the very well-known notable writers, authors are like Amitabh Ghosh, Anita Desai, Hanif Qureshi, Rohinton Mistry, Meena Alexander, Arundhati Roy, Kiran Desai. They have written about their post-colonial experiences. And Nazim Zakir, 1924 to 2004, he was a foundational figure of post-colonial writings. I would begin with Geeta Hariharan. Her literature is considered as the key part of postmodern women's literature in India. She even won Commonwealth Writers Prize in the year 1993 for her work, The Thousand Faces of Night. The novel, it revolves around three generations of women, Devi, Sita, and Mayamma. It is a saga of Indian womanhood caught in the 200-year-old customs and traditions. Her other prominent works are The Art of Dying, When Dream Travels, The Winning Team, Fugitive Histories, which was written in 2009. Shashi Tharoor, who is an Indian politician and writer, to his credit are three novels, a short story collection, and a non-fiction. His works, Reasons of State, which was composed in 1982, the great Indian novel, The $5 Smile and Other Stories. But the work which gained too much of momentum and notice was Riot, a love story composed in 2001. The novel is based on the death of a 24-year-old Priscilla Hurt during the communal riots in the wake of Babri Masjid agitation. It was the time of Hindu-Muslim violence in contemporary India. So the book is based on that. It is a love story. His other works are Bookless in Baghdad, Pax Indica, India and the World of 21st Century, and Era of Darkness, Inglorious Empire in the year 2017. Although there are a number of works, but due to time constraint, I have limited the choices. Next in the row is Mr. V.S. Naipaul, Vidyadhar Suraj Prasad Naipaul, who is from Trinidad and Tobago-born British writer of Indian descent. There is a story of Mohan Biswas, who was striving for success, for an identity. So there are views of a colonial work sharply with post-colonial perspective. And that is all portrayed in his book, A House for Mr. Biswas, which was composed in 1961. He was conferred with Booker Prize in the year 1971 for In a Free State. He received knighthood in Britain in the year 1990. And then in 2001, he was conferred with Nobel Prize in Literature for the novel Half a Life. It is a story of an Indian immigrant to England and Africa. The Writer in the World Essays, 2002, The Mask of Africa, Glimpses of African Belief, which was written in 2010. His novels are known for their pessimistic and cynical tone, often referred to as suppressed histories. Then Arundhati Roy, everyone has heard of her, read her like any other author. Susanna Arundhati Roy, an Indian author, an actress and a political activist who was involved in human rights and environmental causes. She won Man Booker Prize for fiction for her book, The God of Small Things in the year 1997. Then The Cost of Living, which is about an attack on the Indian government regarding handling of Narmada Valley Dam project and its nuclear testing program. Another famous work is Broken Republic, three essays, Capitalism, a Ghost Story, The Mystery of Utmost Happiness. The work blends personal stories with topical issues, including a transgender woman and a resistance fighter in Kashmir. Now moving to Caribbean literature, from Indian to Caribbean, George Lemming is the first poet essayist that I have picked up. The most Barbados novelist, essayist, and an important figure in Caribbean literature. He immigrated to England in the year 1950, became a leader in Caribbean Renaissance that took place in England with other exiles like V.S. Naipaul. He is an author of six novels, and his debut novel is In the Castle of My Skin, where we see the protagonist is in the search for an identity. Another prominent notable works are The Emigrants, Of Age and Innocence, Season of Adventure, Water and Berries, and so on. And critics, they accuse him, they accuse of his novels as soapboxes, for which he preaches his Marxist ideology. Lemming tries to tie together collective history through the shared humanity of his characters. Through his character, he is trying to share the history. Next in the row is Guagi Wa Thuango, who is a novelist, essayist, a short story writer of Kenyan descent. He writes primarily in Gikuyu. A professor of English who taught throughout the world, his early books include Weep Not Child, The River Between, A Grain of Wheat, which was published under names James Googie. What he did was, he dropped his Western first name and adopted current name to emphasize his cultural pride. The Upright Revolution, Why Humans Walk Upright, it was translated into 98 languages. Other well-known novels include Petals of Blood and Wizard of the Crow. His memoir, it was published in the House of the Interpreter in the year 2012. Initially, he wrote realistic works, but his recent works, they are more experimental, aesthetical, and magical. Chinua Achebe, a Nigerian novelist. Albert Chinua Lumogo Achebe is a poet, professor, and a critic, and a dominant figure in modern African literature. Things Fall Apart was his first novel and magnum opus, which occupies a pivotal place in African literature. Along with this is No Longer at Ease and Arrow of God complete the African trilogy. So prominent Igbo writer who sought to escape the effects of colonial perspectives and values that predominated African society. I would read a quote from Morning, yet on Creation Day. I would be quite satisfied by my novels, especially the ones I set in the past, did no more than teach my readers that their past, with all its imperfections, was not one long night of savagery, from which the first Europeans acting on God's behalf delivered them. Wole Soyinka, he is a Nigerian playwright. Akin Wande, Olu Wole, Baba Tunde Soyinka, his full name, who is known as Wole Soyinka. He is a Nigerian playwright, novelist, poet, and an essayist in English language. He was awarded Nobel Prize in Literature in the year 1986. Some of his notable works are The Lion and the Jewel, A Dance of the Forest, which is there in the course as well. The play was presented at the Nigerian Independence Celebration in 1960. It denigrated the glorious African past and warned Nigerians and all Africans that their energies henceforth should be spent trying to avoid repeating the mistakes that have already been made. Next is The Strong Breed, Madmen and Specialists, Document of Identity, which is a radio play, The Interpreter, a very famous novel of his, which was composed in the year 1964. Coming to the Australian literature, Judith Arundel Wright, she was born in New England and came to Brisbane as a young woman. She has been called the conscience of the nation for her passionate commitment to Australia's environment and the Aboriginal land rights movement. She is best remembered for several collections of poetry translated into several languages, including Italian, Japanese, and Russian. Birds was written in 1950s, The Moving Image, The Gateway, MacPeas, Hunting Snake are some of her important works. So we, from the name of the her books, we can make out that she is an environmentalist. How much she's concerned about the nature and the wildlife there. Leslie Allen Murray, also known as Les Murray, is an Australian poet, an anthropologist, essayist, and a critic. He is called as the Bush Bard by the critics. He has published nearly 30 volumes of poetry, 2 verse novels, and a collection of his prose writings. His poetry has been published in 11 different languages, including Hindi. Disposition, relegation, independence were the major preoccupations of his poetry. His meditative lyrical poems as Noonday X-Men and Sydney and the Bush captured Australia's psychic and rural landscape. Another important book is Flowering Eucalyptus in Autumn, which was published in 1983. Sharon Pollock, again from, she is a Canadian playwright. Sharon Pollock, me, Mary, Sharon, Clemmers. She was an actor, an artist director of theatre, Calgary, for the year 1984, then a director for theatre New Brunswick from the year 1988 to 1980, and artist director for Performance Kitchen and the Gary Theatre. One of her dark comedies, A Compulsory Option, which is her first full-length play, was published in the year 1971, and it won Alberta Culture Playwriting Competition. She has written 6 plays for children and several radio and television scripts. She was conferred with Golden Sheep Award in the year 1981 for the television film The Person's Case. Her plays, Walsh, which is there, which has been included in the curriculum of a number of universities, was published in 1974, The Kumagatu Maru Incident 1978, and One Tiger to a Hill earned her the reputation of a playwright with a conscience. Generations was published in 1981, Blood Relations, and these two works, they are concerned with the domestic conflicts of life of that time. Doc is loosely based on Sharon Pollock's own family background. And there is a prison drama as well, Whiskey 6 Kedisa. Margaret Atwood. So Margaret Eleanor Atwood is a Canadian poet, novelist, literary critic, an essayist, teacher, environmental activist, and an inventor. She is best known for her historical, speculative climate, and dystopian fiction. Her notable works, I would like to point out, Surfacing, which came in the year 1972, The Handmaid's Tale, 1985, The Blind Assassins in the year 2000, Oryx and Craig in the year 2003, The Testaments in the year 2019. All these, I have chosen the writers that are there, which are there included in the course of different universities. So students who are listening to it, they will have an idea about these prominent writers. Although there are n number of writers, but it is really difficult to include each one of them in this time frame. So next is Michael Ondaatje. His full name is Philip Michael Ondaatje. He was born in Colombo, Sri Lanka in the year 1943 and moved to England in 1954. He relocated to Canada and became a Canadian citizen in the year 1962. His works include fiction, autobiography, poetry, essays, and films. To his credit are 13 books of poetry. He is a recipient of multiple literary awards, the Giller Prize, the Booker Prize, and the Prix Medicis Estranger Prize. He won the Werner's Journal Award for the collected works of Billy Beckett in the year 1970. Notable works are The English Patient, In the Skin of a Lion in the year 1987. It is a novel about early immigrants who played a major role in the building of the city of Toronto. It is a novel about the wearing and removal of masks, the shedding of skin, the transformation and translation of identity. Running in the Family, Coming Through Slaughter, War Light, these are some of his major works. Next in the row is Babsi Sidhwa. She is an American novelist of Gujarati, Parsi, Zoroastrian descent who writes in English. Babsi Sidhwa is a Pakistani leading diasporic writer. She has produced 4 novels in English that reflect her personal experience of the Indian subcontinent's partition. She wrote about abuse against women, how people, they immigrated, that is immigration to the US, and membership in the Parsi Zoroastrian community. The New York Times has called her Pakistan's finest English language novelist. Her first and second novel, The Bride and The Crow Eaters, mark the beginning of her literary career. Although these were rejected n number of times for publication, but these were the 2 novels that brought her in the limelight. She has authored several novels, Tracking India, An American Brat, The Pakistani Bride, and she was conferred with Sitara A. Imtiaz Award by Pakistan. So this is what I have for today. These were the prominent writers of post-colonial writing that I have focused on. I hope it is of some help.